Hello, I'm Dr. Mal Itchins. I'm a lung cancer medical oncologist working at Royal North Shore Hospital in Sydney and more recently at Chris O'Brien Lifehouse across the bridge. So I predominantly spend my days treating lung cancer, engaging in lung cancer clinical trials across a spectrum of people with diagnosis, not only of lung cancer, but any thoracic cancer. And I also perform research in areas such as understanding drug resistance, understanding molecularly driven lung cancers, and how we can start to formulate more personalized treatments. So as a part of our research into rare cancers in lung cancer, a group of clinicians have gotten together to set up an Australian longitudinal cancer registry, which is called for short Aurora. What we try and do with this platform is to input cases, you know, across, there's 30 centres currently involved, to help us to generate real world data and answer questions outside of clinical trials with what we're seeing sort of in the clinic from diagnosis, you know, until the end of somebody's cancer journey. So with regards to this grant, our plans are to kindly put the money forward to Aurora to help us to further establish specifically the group of individuals in our registry with a diagnosis of a ROS-1 positive lung cancer. At the moment, we have over 100 cases in there, which for a rare cancer is you know, a really important and impactful number. And then what we want to do is start to look at clinical outcomes, as well as matching results with tissue and blood biopsies. I think that the first and foremost impact of this grant is helping to elevate the awareness in the community of rare cancers, being able to collate the experience of those that have had this diagnosis, and to show that although it may be rare in terms of the overall, you know, cancer spectrum of diagnoses, actually there are hundreds of Australians, you know, that are living with a ROS-1 diagnosis. So, you know, awareness and advocacy actually comes hand in hand with the impact of this particular grant, you know, as it helps us to show that it is a priority in Australia, you know, and that there are important and personalised ways we should be treating this cancer. It's very unique to other cancers. You know, it's not alone. There are others in the same family, ALK, RET, even NTRK, which is exceedingly rare, but a very important type. So we group these into what you call fusion lung cancers. And, you know, the way that we treat them, the course, you know, as well as the types of individuals that may be diagnosed with these types of cancers are extremely unique. So I think that that message and, you know, the impact of, you know, following this research through, you know, can only then elevate, you know, the priority for treating this cancer as, you know, as well as we can. The equity of access to care with any kind of cancer or medical condition is so important. You know, I grew up in a farm in Tasmania. I now work in an academic centre in Sydney, and your postcode shouldn't dictate the treatment you receive. So, you know, I think that what is so important in rare cancers is, you know, not everyone can be an expert in them. A lot of people will never treat a ROS-1, you know, lung cancer, even though they're even an oncologist. So we need to have established supportive, you know, communities and networks and those, you know, that share, you know, a similar priority so that, you know, that we can support each other to ensure that if we don't know the answer, we can reach out to somebody who does. I think we do that well in Australia. And what's also very important in those that may have, you know, a diagnosis of a ROS-1 lung cancer is there are really important advocacy groups. The Lung Foundation does a lot of work in this area, Rare Cancers Australia, and also the individual, you know, molecular populations. So there are the ROS-1ers, which are a really prolific, you know, international group of ROS-1 positive lung cancers, empowering people, you know, that have this diagnosis. It can take people some time if they have this diagnosis to find these networks. And I think that we can work on bridging that gap as usually, you know, it can be, you know, too late if they haven't known who to reach out to. So I just think we need to be really visible and we need to keep pushing, and it needs to be very easy to come into the networks if, you know, you're personally affected by a cancer such as a ROS-1. Another important part with equity is making sure that there is visibility and access to clinical trials in rare cancers. It's so important to make sure we're considering, you know, people for trials to help improve the benchmark ongoingly. what's important about the way that we do clinical trials in this space currently is, thankfully, most studies will pay for all expenses for an individual to travel, you know, to the centre to receive their clinical trial. What I hope our next step will be improving teletrials in the country so that people can be treated more and safely, of course, at home. So certainly for rare cancers, there's a lot of advantage if we can start to implement more of a teletrials model in Australia to improve reach. I think to invest more of a national priority into lung cancer research, we probably need to keep agitating, we need to be loud, we need to not accept the current status and standards. We know that lung cancer is still the biggest cancer killer, and it's still a huge health priority, and many people we meet will succumb from their cancer. So until that stops being the norm, we don't stop advocating. And I think that next year in the country, we've committed to screening lung cancer, to improving cure with those with screen detected lung cancers. So we need to put our money where our mouth is and get it right.